This is NHTV2, North Haven Government Television, a service of North Haven Community Television. The following program is brought to you in part through a grant from the Town of North Haven.
Hello, is everybody here? My name is Kenny Foskew. I chair the North Haven Clean Energy Task Force, and I'm a resident of North Haven. I live right down the street on Whalen Street, and I'm, on behalf of the task force, I want to welcome you tonight to this evening's Solarize North Haven launch event. We're really excited. Great turnout. Thanks so much for coming. Before I forget, this is being taped by North Haven Television, so you can tell all your neighbors to watch it later. So the town of North Haven has been selected to participate in this cutting-edge solar program that makes solar easy and affordable, and we'll be providing some details in a little bit. Solarize North Haven is part of Solarize Connecticut, and there have been over 58 communities so far that have done this program. So I know that Connecticut is on the cutting edge of this, and I'll say something about how far we come in North Haven in a little bit. Before we get into the program, I want to tell you a little bit about our group. The North Haven Clean Energy Task Force is a town-sponsored group that has been working since 2007 on energy conservation and promoting clean energy options like solar power. So we have three things we want to do. We want to save money for the town. We want to save money for residents and businesses, because that's a lot about what this is about, energy conservation and clean energy. We want to help spur economic development by growing the clean energy economy. And I was thinking today, wouldn't it be great if we could make solar panels in Connecticut and in North Haven? So work on that, Kate, okay?
Yeah. So,
and of course, we want to save the planet. This is about climate change, and we're all doing something about it in a really good way. So some of our accomplishments so far, including signing up residents and businesses for the clean energy option on utility bill. I'm sure a lot of people have done that. And we earned enough points, and I should say we includes our the Project Green Kids in the back room, and Anthony Giordano, the teacher. You want to wave your hand back there? They did a great job, and we had enough so that we got a solar array on the high school. And how many people have seen that? Okay, great. We've conducted public forums on climate change, energy conservation, solar energy, and programs that benefit the business community, and we want to continue that work, especially with the business community in North Haven. And we've been working with the town to develop a municipal action plan and with EPA to conduct energy benchmarking of town buildings as we move toward energy conservation. And we've been worked with the first selectman on choosing Johnson Controls as a company that's going to be doing a lot of conservation work in the town buildings. And Mike will be talking a little bit about that. And most recently, last year, we coordinated the North Haven Energy Efficiency Challenge to encourage residents to participate in the Home Energy Solutions campaign or to get home energy audits. How many people out there got a home energy audit? A good number, okay. And we were so successful, we had over 500 residents to sign up, and the vendor was given $25 a piece for each person who signed up. And you may have seen this in the paper, but we earned over $12,000 to give to Sarah, Sarah Foundation here. So we're just been moving right along here. And one project we're working on right now is working with the town to purchase EV or electric vehicle charge stations, which one of them will probably be at the Energize Connecticut store on Universal Drive. Didn't want to forget to say that we are always looking for new members. Please talk to any of us after the presentation, and you can also go to our webpage on the town website. And I want to ask the members of the Clean Energy Task Force to stand up and wave your hand now, so people can ask them questions before we leave, maybe. So let's move on. You may not be aware of this, but North Haven is really on the map. I think not just statewide, but nationally, in terms of being a leader in Connecticut for energy conservation and clean energy. And North Haven this past year was one of just five Connecticut towns recognized by the Clean Energy Communities Program as a gold medal winner. And right now, I'd like to introduce the man who is greatly responsible for this. He's been a great leader. Our first electman, Mike Frieda, come up and say some words. So.
Thank you very much, Ken. He really gave an outstanding overview in terms of what we've been doing here in North Haven. But I'd like to share with you a couple of other projects, concepts, and initiatives that we've brought forward here. As you're driving up Universal Drive going towards Sackett Point Road, you may notice the solar panel park that's on the site of the old landfill. It was one of the goals of our administration working with the Clean Energy Task Force to identify a huge parcel of land that could never be developed in the future and turn it into a productive use. So what you see there is 0.34 megawatts of power, and that power is virtual metered to the Water Pollution Control Authority. You may not realize that the largest energy user of all the town buildings in North Haven is what we call the WPCA, the Water Pollution Control Authority. So that is designed to offset about 35% of the energy costs of that WPCA, which is a significant savings to the taxpayers of North Haven. We are also looking at expanding that. We have the contractor out there to see if we can expand that, and we have a bold, audacious goal of empowering or powering that plant 100% through solar energy, and that would mean we'd need more capacity. It was my goal originally to make that 1 megawatt. For the future, I'd love to see a 9 megawatt facility, which is a really large goal, but that could not only power town buildings, but also help some of our businesses and our residents. Ken referenced that we are in the top 5 communities in the state, achieving a gold star because of the variety of initiatives that we have brought forward. Ken referenced Johnson Controls. You may have read the story, or you may not be aware, that we've identified about $6 billion of future savings in the town of North Haven. And through a performance contract with Johnson Controls, we are now updating all of the major equipment in our schools and some of the town buildings to get them to be more energy efficient. And we're paying back over a 17 to 20 year period the cost of, as an example, a new boiler at Monowee School. We're paying that back through the energy savings between what we were once paying for energy costs and the result of the savings that's derived from the new updated equipment in all the buildings and all the schools. And it's a very unique contract and performance contract that we're doing, again, designed to save the taxpayers money and to be more efficient. As all this was happening, we have been going out to a world auction and have done this for energy rates in the town. We've locked in at one of the lowest rates possible for the next 2.5 years from a cents per kilowatt standpoint. So we're calculating correctly through some of the advice we're getting from some of the consultants. We go out to competitive bid every year, watching energy costs. We, working with the United Illuminating Company, hope to be one of the first communities in the United Illuminating service area to have LED streetlights. As an example, if someone calls me up, and people call me up often, and they'd like a streetlight at the end of a cul-de-sac where it's dark, the process is I would authorize it, and I always do. I have the UI out there. They take a look at it, and they see if it's plausible. And then the town pays X amount of dollars a month for that electricity. The idea that we have is to eventually retrofit all of the streetlights throughout North Haven with LED lights, which would save us a significant amount of money. Now, as all this was happening, we started to work with Kate Donnelly. Our Clean Energy Task Force had been talking to me about residential solar. And we had a series of meetings, and what we determined, myself, the Clean Energy Task Force, Ed Swinkowski in town, that there was an opportunity. There was an opportunity to leverage the town's aggregate purchasing power to work with Kate Solarize Connecticut to deliver what could be the best possible price to you as a consumer by narrowing down those contractors who wanted to participate in Solarize Connecticut in the form of an RFP, which is basically a competitive bid. We think that this concept, we don't think we know, would allow you to derive our aggregate purchasing power to give you a very good price should you decide to go with solar. Now, throughout the town, there are residents that are involved with solar. And I have to tell you that I hear a lot of positive things about residential solar. There's a lot of companies out there. This program is designed to present to you, I think it's two contractors, I think, right, Kate? One contractor, I'm sorry, that you could listen to and determine whether or not you would like solar. It's a very unique program that can have some significant benefits to each of you. So in conclusion, I'd like to say that we in the town have done an awful lot and will continue to try to reduce energy costs in town. We now have offered here what you'll see tonight, a program for your consideration that you as homeowners will have to make the decision if you'd like to participate. Solarize Connecticut will be the ones to manage the program, to answer your questions, to send a contractor out to visit you on site, to talk to you about the options that you may have in your respective homes. And ladies and gentlemen, as we move forward in North Haven, I can tell you through the efforts of this wonderful Clean Energy Task Force, through the collaboration that we have with the state of Connecticut and the UI, working with the contractors that we have that we're using solar for our municipal buildings, and our next goal is the second largest energy user in town, which is the town pool, to figure out a solution there, whether it's solar or some other alternative if we can't put solar panels on the roof of the pool. We are committed to continue to save costs and continue to deliver profitable dollars for the taxpayers in terms of the energy that we use. With that being said, ladies and gentlemen, I hope that you enjoy this presentation. I am delighted to see this wonderful group here. My office got an awful lot of calls on this, confirming that tonight was the night, and I'm very happy to see the level of interest here. Thank you very much. It's great to see everybody.
Thank you, Mike. Now I want to introduce Kate Donnelly, who is the Community Outreach Manager with Smart Power, a nonprofit organization assisting us with the Solarize North Haven campaign, and she'll give us a brief overview of the Solarize program and some of the parts to that.
Thank you all. It's such a privilege and a pleasure to be in North Haven and in a community so committed to not only saving its citizens money, but actually helping the environment. So thank you, Kenny and Mike, and it's been great to work with all the members of this task force. I work with an organization called Smart Power. We are a nonprofit marketing firm, and we've been hired by the Connecticut Green Bank to work in different communities on Solarize programs. Solarize began in 2012. We've successfully had five rounds with 58 communities around the state. And each of those communities have more than doubled the amount of residential solar. The program is really for residences. We know that there's a lot going on in towns and in large corporations, Walmart, Kohl's, a lot of different companies are doing solar. But the Connecticut Green Bank wanted to make sure that the residents had the same kind of opportunity to the savings and as the towns and the companies. So the whole idea of Solarize, it's a program that began in Oregon and moved to Massachusetts, and the Connecticut Green Bank and Smart Power adapted that program for the state. And the whole idea of it is to make solar simple for people and affordable. It's a really simple technology, and Sunlight Solar will get into that technology later. It's very simple, but the process of purchasing a solar installation is not that simple. So this is a way to, these Solarize campaigns are a way to educate you around how solar works and how the financing works and all of that. So we're happy to see all of you here tonight. It's an 18-week campaign. We will be working with all the members of people in North Haven. If you're interested in finding out if your home is good for solar, there'll be plenty of opportunities to do that. These are some of the people involved, some of the organizations involved in providing Solarize to the state. Smart Power, as I said, is a nonprofit marketing firm. We've done campaigns not only in Connecticut, but many other states across the country. The Connecticut Green Bank are the people who bring you the solar incentives. So you'll see later how much those incentives are. And they really are the innovators that spark all the work around solar and renewable energy in the state of Connecticut. Sunlight Solar is the chosen installer for North Haven, and Dividend Solar is a financing organization that is bringing a very good product, a loan product to you, which you can choose to use if that's the way you want to go. There is a website that's dedicated to North Haven, solarizect.com/North Haven. And this is, if you go home tonight and you don't remember what happened, you know, what all the facts and figures, or if you want to find out about upcoming events that might be happening, you can go to this website and it will have frequently asked questions. You can sign up on a form to get a free solar assessment. There's an event calendar. There's testimonials from local homeowners who have gone solar and what their experience has been. There's just a lot of information there, and it's really a good resource. So go on. It's on the bottom of all the flyers that you have. Just use it. It's a good resource. I just wanted to briefly go over the selection process of the solar installer. And you might ask, why do we have one installer for North Haven? And really, we found that to work with a selected installer really realizes a lot of savings for the town, because that installer can sort of aggregate all their work in one town, save money on their marketing costs because the town is helping them with that. And for that, they're giving a really good price for solar with very good equipment. And the way this installer was chosen, Sunlight Solar, was, as Mike said, there was a request for proposals that went out to all the solar installers in the state of Connecticut. There are around 80. We received proposals from those interested in working on the Solarize campaigns. And then three members from North Haven came up to Rocky Hill at the Connecticut Green Bank and reviewed those proposals. And as a result of that review, they did that with one of the Connecticut Green Bank employees who is very knowledgeable about solar and the equipment and the reputation of the companies and all of that. They chose a few to interview, and then the installers came down to North Haven, and there are three or four people from the town as well as the Energy Committee interviewed the installation companies, and ultimately they chose to go with Sunlight Solar. So they weren't pulled out of a hat. They're a company that was vetted very carefully by the town. And this is some of the criteria that they looked at. Pricing, it's a good, you know, solid price for the equipment. They've got a great deal of experience in the state of Connecticut. There's good customer satisfaction from the work that they've done, and they can handle the capacity of doing a Solarize campaign in North Haven. It's really impressive how much solar you already have. I think it's upwards of 180 households have solar, which is really quite a bit in the state of Connecticut. Some communities have very little. So you're really way ahead of the game, and we hope that this will be more than doubled. So at the end of the campaign, well, let's hope for over, you know, that you'll have a 360, 400, 500 households that have solar. So these are some of the reasons that Sunlight Solar was chosen. They are located in New Haven, so they're a nearby installer. I'd like to just ask how many solar owners are there here tonight? So there's quite a few. Great. We are looking to get some help from you to talk to your neighbors about solar. So if people have, we hope to have a solar tour later on in the campaign where people, you can go to some of these households and talk to people about their solar experience. There is a deadline. The deadline is May 31st. That's not the deadline to have your system installed. It's the deadline to sign the contract. So it's really important that you sign up early. The site assessment is free. You don't have to pay anything for that. And also, one of the things to keep in mind is that the town is bringing you a solar installation company that they feel good about. But you're always free to go get other estimates from other companies and compare it to what this is. So, but in order to do all that, it takes time. It takes more time than you think. So I recommend that you sign up early, and so you have plenty of opportunity to sign that contract by May 31st if you so choose. When you go home, if you can like us, Solarize CT, on Facebook and Twitter. We do have regular articles about solar that come up, and as well as upcoming events, not only in North Haven, but around the state. So that's it. That's my information. If you want to get in touch with Smart Power, or you want to get any contacts from the Connecticut Green Bank, you're welcome to talk to me after this presentation, or just contact me in the future. So thanks for coming, and back to Kenny.
Thank you, Kate. I wanted to mention before I introduce Brennan that we are going to have questions and answers after this. So now I want to come to the main event, what people came out here for. And so now I would like to introduce Brendan Smith, who's design manager for Sunlight Solar Energy Company. Sunlight Solar is our chosen vendor, as Kate said, for our campaign. He will explain the program, including installation, financing, and answer questions. Take it away, Brenda. Thank you.
Thank you, Kenny. And thanks, everybody, for coming. It's a great turnout. Hopefully, you guys are all dug out okay from the storm this weekend. If that's the worst Mother Nature is going to do this winter, I think we'll be in pretty good shape. So yeah, like Kenny said, I'm Brendan Smith from Sunlight Solar. We're the chosen installer for the Solarize campaign. Kenny also mentioned that North Haven is really on the map for energy efficiency and renewable energy, so we're hoping to solidify that with this renewable energy campaign, this solar campaign. So Kate already talked about it a little bit, but why Solarize? The main benefit is that a lot of the vetting is done for you. So there are a lot of solar companies to choose out there, and being out on your own, getting multiple quotes can be somewhat cumbersome, so the town has gone through a rigorous selection process to whittle that down for you. So we're offering one group rate for everyone, with a great pre-designed system that is using some of the best equipment that we have available, with some optional add-ons that we'll go over as we go through this. The other option is that because there's a financing partner, Dividend, we can offer a zero upfront cost to owning this system, and we'll go into a little bit more detail about that. So why Sunlight Solar? We have about 25 years in the business. Our owner, Paul Israel, started the company back in 1988 over on the West Coast, and then subsequently started offices over here on the East Coast in Connecticut and Massachusetts around 2004. So a little over 10 years in Connecticut. We're a local installer, so we're your neighbors just down in New Haven. And I live in Hamden, even closer. This is something that's important to us, is if you have us come out and do a site assessment, it's not about getting a sales pitch. It's really about being informative so you can learn a lot about solar and see what options are out there and make the choices that are right for you. And again, we're offering the best equipment that we're able to. So why solar? Probably the obvious reason is save money, which we've already talked about. Your electric rates from the utility company, UI, on average are rising by about 3% per year or even more. Solar, the idea behind it is that you replace your need to purchase power from the utility company, and whether you purchase it just outright with cash or through a loan, you're fixing the cost of that power for the life of the system, which can be on the order of 30 or 40 years. So it makes your cost of power very reliable. Why are you able to do this? Why are you able to put a PV system up on your roof and actually have it cost less than the utility company? It wasn't always the case. Cost of panels has come down immensely, 80% since 2008. Lately we have seen prices somewhat stabilize. So there are signs that we're sort of leveling off. An average size system, and we'll go over what an average size system is, can literally save you tens of thousands of dollars over the life of the system. On average, in this program, you can expect to see an internal rate of return of anywhere from 9 to 13%, depending on how much sun you get at your site. To put this in scale, I imagine a 401k gets somewhere around a 4.5% rate of return. So it's a really good place to put money for long-term savings. And we're looking at payback periods as short as 7 years. So you get your money back in 7 years. Obviously, as we've already covered, it's also about reducing your carbon footprint. It literally saves tons of carbon every year in replaced production from a power plant. And also does the work of literally acres of trees over its lifetime, as far as reducing the amount of carbon that's in the atmosphere. Something we don't talk a lot about, but stability and security of distributed energy generation, that's kind of a mouthful, but distributed energy is the concept of, rather than having one centralized power plant that's supplying power out to, you know, many houses and buildings, you distribute that production out to those buildings and houses, which provides stability as far as, you know, meeting the demand for power in these areas and, you know, making it less susceptible to power outages or even terrorist attacks that target infrastructure. So solar PV will be a big part of that in the future. Also, solar is awesome. I have a PV system on my house, and it's just fun. Like it comes with a data monitor, so you can track your production. If you're like me, you'll check it once a day or every hour or so while you're supposed to be getting work done. You'll go out early in the morning in your slippers and watch the sun shine on the panels. Yeah, no, it's good. So what makes a site good for solar? If you choose to sign up for a site assessment, actually Janice in our office will give you a call, or somebody else if there's really high volume. You'll talk to one of us. We'll look at your house from a satellite image. We usually can tell right off the bat if it's a good candidate for solar. And then if you'd like, we set up a site assessment and we'll send out one of our system designers to talk to you about it in more detail. What the system designer is going to be looking at are three main things. The first is the orientation of your house. So ideally, you have a nice south-facing roof because that's where you'll get the most solar exposure. So we're going to measure how far off from south it is. Orientation. We'll measure the pitch of your roof. For a south-facing roof, that's around a 35-degree pitch roof. If you've got an east or west-facing roof, you can still do solar. You just might want a slightly lower pitch roof. Number three, and by far the most important, is the amount of shade that you have. Shade is a big enemy of solar. A lot of the payback that you see is related to how much sun you get on your roof. So if you've got a bunch of large trees that you're not willing to take down, probably solar is not a good option for you. We have some special tools that we'll bring on site that can be used to assess how much shading will impact your production throughout the year. And then lastly, sizing the system. So we'll do this based on your annual kilowatt hour usage. So we'll look at your electric bill while we're on site and tally up how much power you use over the course of a year, and that's how we size the system. The PV system is going to produce power throughout the year, and it's cyclical as the seasons go. So once you have one complete year of production, that should match or eliminate as much of your annual usage as possible. So this example system here is a little larger than what we would consider an average size system. Just this upper roof should be enough for most homes. So let's take a look at what this looks like for an actual home. So again, this is a bit of a larger system. This upper roof should be enough space to power the average size home and how much usage it has annually. So first, we'll look at the solar panels, or solar modules, solar PV modules. These are made up of solar cells, and that's where the power production is happening. These cells are all wired together, and then they're placed behind tempered glass, and then on the backside, there's a backsheet that seals it from the elements. And then this is all surrounded by an aluminum frame, which gives it stability and is an anchor point so you can secure it to the roof. There's a base panel that we're using, which is an LG 315-watt panel. If you're not familiar with panel wattages, this is a very high wattage panel. Some of the highest wattage panels that are out there. We also have optional all-black panels. So you can see this one has a white backsheet, so you can see some of the backsheet peeking through behind the cells. This is an all-black panel. Looks a little bit more sleek and kind of blends together. We also have US-made options made by Solar World. They produce their panels over in Oregon. And then we have high-efficiency panels made by SunPower. High-efficiency meaning more power per square foot of roof space. So if you have a small roof space and your goal is to cover as much of your bill as possible, SunPower is a great way to go. So let's take a look at underneath the solar array. So this is how a system is attached. We have the panels sit on rails. Those rails are attached to brackets that will mount through your roof and lag into the rafter supports in your roof. At each one of these anchor points, we have a special flashing that's designed to make this attachment watertight. Underneath the array, along the racking, you can't really see it. That's how we do the wire management. So all of these panels need to be connected up with each other. So we'll tuck the wires underneath the panels. This right here is a power optimizer. We'll talk about that in a little more detail later on. Another thing I want to point out on here is you can see a roof plumbing vent. So plumbing vents, skylights, things like that we'll want to work around. So these are modular panels, so we're able to kind of place them and avoid these things. Next, we want to look at how do we get the power from the roof down to wherever your electrical panel is, so usually in the basement or in the garage. So we call this the wire run. So you can see a small conduit coming out of the attic. Sometimes we can go over the edge of the roof. And this will follow down typically we'll try and get to the power meter that's on your house, and then go inside the basement. We're looking for your electrical panel, so the main panel to your house. This will be part of the assessment when you have somebody come out, is they'll want to look in the basement and look at your electrical setup. The other key component is an inverter. This is an inverter right here, and then a PV meter. So this is what I was talking about with data monitoring. So this will keep track of how much power your system puts out. Here's where we talk about power optimizers. So the inverter system that we have for this program is called SolarEdge. If you've heard of microinverters, this is a similar technology to that. In this case, you have one central inverter that's down in the basement, and then on the back of each panel, you have a power optimizer, which, among other things, makes each panel power independent. On older systems, typically the panels are wired together in series, so if you shade one of the panels, it lowers the output of the other panels on the system. So back to the shade being a really important factor. With power optimizers, if you're shading one of the panels, it's going to have no effect on the other panels. The other nice benefit is that you get a pretty slick monitoring system that lets you track the output of each panel individually. So like this past weekend, you get snow on your array. If you have a monitoring system like this, you can actually watch the snow melting off the array and the panels switch on throughout the day. So again, we're tying back into the electrical panel, and then power goes back out to the utility meter. Actually, quick thing I'll note down here, you see there's a generator on this house. So it's a common question. If you have a generator, we just need to know that ahead of time, which we'll know from the assessment. And we tie in a little bit differently, but it works seamlessly with a generator. So how does this work with the utility company? So with this diagram, again, we got photovoltaic, the solar panels up on the roof, going down to the inverter down in the basement, tying into the electrical panel to the house. We've got the utility meter and the utility grid. So this is UI's side of things. What UI is going to do is once your system is powered on, they're going to replace your existing meter with what's called a net meter. The net meter measures power going both ways. So on any given day, when your panels are producing power, you'll be using some of the power from the panels in your house, possibly some power from the grid. At night, you'll be using entirely power from the grid. And then there'll even be times when you're really cranking away and you're not using much power in the house that you'll be sending power back out to the grid. So what the net meter is going to do is record all of this power coming in and power going out. And then when you get your bill at the end of the month, they'll subtract the amount of power that you took from them, or sorry, other way around. They'll subtract the amount of power that you sent out to UI from the amount of power that you used, and that is how you're billed. So let's take a look at how that shapes out on your electric bill. This photo I got off of UI's website, this is their stock photo. This is how happy they think we are when we get our electric bills. you will be this happy once you've gone solar. Because you'll look at your bills, and they'll look like my bill, $17.25. So all of my bills look like this. I don't have this up here just to brag about it. So what solar is doing is it's reducing your meter reading. So you see all these zeros next to these kWh, kilowatt hour charges. If you haven't looked at your bill, take another look at it tonight if you've got one. So they take a meter reading and then multiply it times all these different charges. So what solar is doing is reducing this kilowatt hour number So anything that's multiplied by a kilowatt hour number is going to be reduced or eliminated by solar. You'll notice the one charge that's not multiplied by kilowatt hours is the $17.25 charge. It's basically like a connection fee. So even if you're like my house and you eliminate all of your usage, you'll still get a $17.25 charge. So this is what will happen to that little graph that's on the back too. So you go from using power to using nothing. This will be a slightly new section that'll be on your bill. The new thing will be this virtual meter that's showing how much power you sent back. So you don't really have to get into the nitty-gritty of that, but your bill will look a little bit different. Let's look at some of the numbers as far as financially. This is what the proposal will look like once your system designer has run all the numbers. We've got an overall system cost, various incentives, and then we'll look at some of the investment aspects. So this is for an average size system, that area that I highlighted, that upper roof area. This is roughly that size system that should meet the average home's electricity needs. So with the bulk rate pricing, this is the overall price of a system. The Connecticut Green Bank is going to contribute about $3,200 towards this. So this gets subtracted from the overall cost before you're charged. So this would be your out-of-pocket amount. And then you're able to apply a federal tax credit. So you'll have this out-of-pocket amount, and then when you file your taxes in the year that your system's powered on, you'll be able to claim, in this case, a $6,300 tax credit. So this is your net price at the end of all of that. For this average size system, it's a 7 kilowatt system that's producing around 8,200 kilowatt hours a year. That translates at current rates to about, you know, $1,500-$1,600 over the course of a year. Now, obviously, as rates go up, that 3% every year, this number is going to keep going up. But if you purchase the system outright, you've purchased it once, and you're insulated from those rate increases. So internal rate of return, this is kind of average size site, average, what we call design factor, which is basically how sunny your site is. We're showing an almost 12% return on investment, 8% payback period, and then cumulative 25-year savings of over $38,000. One thing I'll note, you will need to make sure that you have the tax liability, obviously, to take a tax credit. Solar is property and sales tax exempt. So for one, there won't be sales tax charged when you purchase the system. And then also, the tax assessor is not going to assess this as an increased value to your house. It's exempt from property taxes. So if you're more interested in a low or no money down option, like we said, we're partnering with Dividend Solar. And what they're going to be able to do is finance the entire system. Whoops. Finance the entire system, so no money down. You'll make a monthly payment pre-tax. So you'll start making payments at this level. Then when you get your tax credit back, you pay that back towards the loan. They re-amortize it down, and you get a lower monthly payment. So in this case, in this example, your annual cost for the loan is a little over $1,400. And as we saw, you're saving $1,500 or $1,600 on your electric bill. So we call this cash flow positive. So what this chart is showing you is the orange line is your 25-year cost of power if you don't do solar, marching up by 3% every year, versus a 20-year loan starts out a little bit lower than what you're paying right now and stays fixed over 20 years and then drops to nothing. So this kind of funny-shaped thing represents your 25-year savings, which we have down here. With a loan, no money down, your 25-year savings is a little over $24,000. There are a few kind of ins and outs details about the incentives that your system designer can go over with you. The main thing to note, so it's paid out the state incentive is paid based on the amount of watts you're installing. So in this case, 51.3 cents per watt. That probably doesn't mean a whole lot to you. What's important to consider is that that number is constantly going down. Every year, sometimes, you know, more, you know, sometimes twice a year, that incentive that you get from the state is dwindling. So we have a great fixed cost for the system, but you want to take advantage of it while you can, because incentives are dwindling. So what are the steps after you decide to move ahead with solar? So if you decide to sign up with us, the first step is, if you're doing any financing, you're going to want to get your financing straightened out so you get approved for the loan. Then most of these other steps are things for Sunlight Solar to do. So first, we're going to apply for your incentive through the Connecticut Green Bank. We submit an application for utility interconnection. We'll do any sort of engineering that's required, structural engineering, to ensure that your roof can withstand the weight. We'll apply for a permit on your behalf with the town. Then we'll be ready to schedule your installation. Installation typically will take 2 or 3 days, depending on the size of your system. Then we'll coordinate inspection from the town. They sign off on it and pass it back to the utility company. They do their own inspection. They'll do some other tests, a witness test. And then finally, they'll give you approval to energize. So this is what Kate was talking about, that this, it's a complicated process. Fortunately, this is entirely turnkey. We're going to handle all of this. Here and there, you'll have to sign some things. But for the most part, we take care of everything. That important date, May 31st, is the deadline just to sign a contract. You don't have to be installed, but it is an important date. It's worth mentioning a couple times. May 31st. Don't forget. It's May 31st. Sign a contract before May 31st. May 31st. Hopefully that sunk in. And if you want to sign up, you'll sign up at the sign-in sheet out there. So let's open to questions. I think I saw that hand first.
You had, in your example, UI supplying the electricity as the supplier. Can you do this with other suppliers, or does it have to be with UI?
You can do it with other suppliers. If you're able to eliminate your bill, it kind of doesn't matter who your supplier is, because you won't be buying any power from them. There are, I won't get into the details of it, but it can be problematic if you are switching suppliers often while you have solar. What happens is you bank these kilowatt hour credits in months where you produce more than you use. Some alternative suppliers, if you switch, they won't forward those banked credits over to your new supplier. So once you do go solar, it's not a great idea to just keep jumping around. Yeah.
If more than a few people in the neighborhood tie into this, what's the response rate with the UI as far as changing the transformers out? Because they've got to do stuff so that we don't backfeed into the system. So how do you make it so that the citizens in the same neighborhood sign up for it?
Yeah, that's a good question. That's part of the utility interconnection process. That's why before we begin an installation, we submit to the utility company, and they'll take a look at transformer sizing, and if something looks like it's over capacity, they'll do kind of a further study. In most cases, I'd say in all cases, I haven't seen where a homeowner was actually disqualified. I know it does happen if the transformer is undersized. So that kind of answers your question. But
will the solar ICP take care of making sure that's done, or you just don't get it?
I mean, we'd have to look at the cost because it's going to be different for any part of the grid that we're tying into.
If they have to upgrade the transformer.
Right. Yeah.
More something that we notice on commercial properties, we really don't notice it as much in residential areas. And that's pretty much one of the first things that we do is we fill out the interconnection application. So we'll know that ahead of time. And it's, I would say 99% of the time, there's no issue with that.
It's not going to be something that's sprung on you and you're going to be expected to pay for it if that does come up. It's very unlikely that that'll come up, though. Yes.
Maintenance.
Good question. I thought I included that in there, but I didn't. Fairly maintenance-free. We've got over 800 systems around the state, and doing maintenance on those is not a huge part of what we do. The main thing is you'll want to check that data monitor, you know, once a week, once a month. Just make sure that you're meeting the production targets that we'll have on your agreement. And let us know if you're not. We have a 10-year production guarantee, so we're guaranteeing that you'll get the output we promise over those 10 years. So there's no real moving parts to this. PV panels can last without any problems for 30, 40 years.
Can you repeat the questions?
Oh, yeah. I'll repeat questions.
So assuming that your property is not optimal but still suitable, and assuming you can't pay cash so you have to finance it, you may be on the lower end of that rate of return, and then what happens if the federal tax incentive goes away? Then you may be negative.
Yeah, so the question, it seemed like more than one question. First part is if you have a less than optimal site, what does that payback period look like? And that is, so I did mention the payback period is tied directly to how much sun you get at your site. So that's part of why we have a system designer out at the site, is that if you have a less than optimal site, we're gonna measure that specifically for your site, give you a production estimate, we'll give you a cash flow analysis like that, and let you make the decision whether it's worthwhile to pursue. As far as the tax credit going away, the tax credit is actually, if you heard in the news, it was set to expire at the end of 2016, and they've extended that out to 2022, I think it was. So we're great on the tax credit. It's the state incentive that is slowly stepping down.
Thanks.
Yeah.
And if I may, what if you're a new homeowner and you don't have that history to show?
Good question. Yeah. So what the? It's tough. I'm sorry. The question was what if you don't have if you just moved into the house or it's a brand new house and you don't have a year's worth of electricity usage, how do you size the system? To be honest, it's a bit of a guess. So you can. There's some educated guesses you can make based on, you know, whether you have electric heat, electric hot water, in any case, yeah, it's more or less a guess. But you will get an incentive. Yeah. So my usual tact for that is you know, better to undersize and then add later than to have a system that's larger than what you need.
Thank you.
Sure. Yes?
What about if you have to replace your roof? And what happens if these things blow off in a hurricane?
Great. Two questions. What if you have to replace your roof? And what if these things blow over in a hurricane? So the roof question is important. You want to make sure that you have, you know, a good 15 years life left on your roof. You don't want to put a system up on a roof that's going to need to be replaced in 5 years, because that will mean taking the system down, replacing the roof, putting the system back up. So that's one of the things we take a look at when we're on site, and what we'll ask you is, how old is the roof? On average, to replace a system, take it down, let the roofers put it back up, you're talking about $3,000 to $5,000. So it's considerable. As far as the hurricane, that comes into the engineering section. Each town will require a stamped letter from a professional engineer asserting that it's meant to withstand the wind speeds. Of a hurricane, of the local prevailing hurricane wind zone. They're installing these systems down in Florida, where they get real hurricanes. And so the racking systems are designed to handle that. Yep, back there. I'm sorry, can you repeat that again?
What if you're not getting enough? It's not optimum. You're not getting 100% power from your system. Maybe 75, maybe even 50.
Yeah, excellent question. So I think the goal of a lot of people, the goal at my house, was to cover 100% of your usage. It can seem discouraging to only cover 50% or even 30% in some cases. But you're still saving money, even if you're not covering 100% of your bill. That portion of your bill is going to be a fixed lower cost than buying that 30% or 50% of power from the utility company. The analogy I always use is you're planning to go on a big road trip. There's two gas stations by your house. One sells gas at X rate. The other sells at half price, but they only fill your tank up 30% of the way. You're still going to go to that gas station first, fill up with the discounted gas, then fill up the rest of the way with the other one. Yes?
If I understand it, the old normal grid goes down for whatever reason, the solar shuts off the grid. Can that individual house still draw power off the solar during that outage?
So unfortunately, no. So the question was, when the power goes out, will you get power off of the system? And no, this is what's called a grid-tied system. So when the power goes out, the system is designed to shut down automatically.
So it's not improved terrorist protection?
Not on an individual homeowner scale.
Still out of power.
Yep, just still out of power. What will be coming down the road in the future is battery storage. There is an option right now where you could store the power locally in batteries, so that when the power goes out, you both can operate your PV system to power the house and use batteries at night. They're fairly costly, and they're not cost competitive against having a backup generator, like a gas powered generator. But yeah, you gotta meet fire codes. But you know, we do them here and there. We do battery backup systems. Yeah, good question. So the question was, who pays for damage to the system? Say if Dennis the Menace next door throws a rock at your panels, typically that'll fall under homeowner's insurance, along with things like damaged, if a tree falls on the array or something, God forbid, a fire. Those typically fall under homeowner's insurance. In most cases, homeowner's insurance will cover it without any increase to your homeowner's insurance. The most I've heard is anywhere from $50 to $100 added on to your homeowner's premium a year. So not insignificant, but not really cutting into the savings. Yes?
In case of a fire, would the firemen have to knock out the panels? You know, the fire's going to be released in the attic?
Yeah, good question. So in the case of a fire, how do firefighters deal with this? That actually plays into the power optimizers that we're offering with this program. There's a new requirement in the next electrical code that's meant for firefighting that's called rapid shutdown, so that when a firefighter comes to a building or a house that's on fire and they need to shut the power down, on a typical inverter, when you shut power down to the house, the inverter will shut down, but the lines from the PV system down to the inverter will still be live, assuming that there's sun out. In this power optimizer system, the inverter, once it's signaled to shut down, it sends a signal up to the power optimizers and, in essence, cuts power from the panels down through the house. So the firefighters are still not going to want to put an axe right through the panels themselves, but at least there's not live wires running through the house. Yes?
My monthly bill runs about $70 to $90. Does it make sense to spend $15,000 a year, or $15,000 to put a system in?
Well, fortunately, if your bills are that low, you won't need a system this size. So that even that average size system is going to be larger than what you need. So your system designer will be able to size the system specifically to meet your needs, and it should be at a much lower price.
So the total cost would be, let's say, for example, could be $10,000 instead of
$15,000. Yep. The interesting thing about this program is, since we have a fixed dollar per watt cost, it doesn't matter the size of the system within reason. It doesn't matter the size of the system, your payback is going to look the same depending on, assuming that you have a nice sunny roof space. So even smaller systems can see an 8-year payback plus. Yes? Yeah, I meant to mention that as well. So if you're not able to take the tax incentive, if you're retired and you don't have the income to pay taxes, we do have a zero down lease option as well. So we can look at that if it's necessary. Most, the industry seems to be trending towards solar loans rather than solar leases, and we're finding most people are preferring the loans. So we're doing less leasing than we have in the past, but we still have the option.
What are the options of lease?
So a lease is a little bit different. It has some similarities. So with a lease, it's third-party owned, so a leasing company will purchase the system and all the installation costs from us, and then you basically pay a leasing fee once a month for the panels. Most leases are on a 20-year scale.
How does it compare?
I don't have the numbers right at the top of my head, but it's yeah.
About comparable to the leasing program that's currently out in Connecticut now. 25-year lease. It's about what they call a 3% escalator per year, which means that the lease payments will be going up 3% per year. The idea is to try to make the lease payments a little bit below what the annual cost of the utility is. You don't own the system, and under Sunnova's rules, you can't buy the system at the end of the 25 years. So the reality of it is that when you're looking at payment plans, even without the federal tax credit, it looks like the loan option zero down for a period of up to 20 years is still more attractive than the lease. You also get, if you can take the federal tax credit, you get that. You get the state incentive, which is not something that you get with the lease. And you also get the value of the solar system added to your home if you ever decide to sell. The real estate agent will come and they will assess the solar system as part of your property, and they will add that amount accordingly. With a lease, you get no value because you don't own it.
Thanks, Janice.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
So, the lease is 40 years, you said, right?
The lease is
25 years.
The loan is 20 years?
Yep.
The loan options that we have, one is 20 years, and the other one goes in increments of 5 years.
So the question is, what if you move before the loan period is over? With any of the loan options we have, you'll have the option to either assign the loan to the new homeowner, and they'll just pick up the loan where you left off. If they don't want to do that, the other option is you can pay off the loan early with no prepayment penalty and sell the system along with the house. Or if they wanted to, the subsequent homeowner could take over the loan and then pay it off themselves.
We have been asked, by the way, if the new homeowner, what happens if they don't want the system at all and they want to take it down? The odds are very good that if the new homeowner is looking at your house and there's a solar system on it that they don't want, they probably won't buy your house. They'd be insane not to buy a house with a solar system, because anybody knows that the rate of power that you are paying is a lot lower than your neighbors without a solar system. So, you know, you think about it, it's like, why wouldn't you want the house with the solar system? That's silly.
Does it have the value of the house?
Yes, it does. And there have been studies by Berkeley Laboratories that have shown exactly how much that is.
Yes. That's a good question. So the question is, what happened?
Repeat the question.
Yeah, I am. what happens if you produce more power than you use in a particular month? So what happens is they'll subtract how much power you sent out to UI from how much power you used from UI. And if you produced more than you used, you'll get a credit that'll carry over to the next month. One important factor to that is those credits, you can keep accumulating them every month. They'll keep rolling over every month until March of every year. That's the end of their fiscal year. At that point, they'll cash you out at the wholesale generation rate, which is a tiny fraction of what you pay for power from them. So it's not in your interest to make yourself a giant power plant that's producing more than you use. It's usually we'll try and size the system up to 100% and stop there. Yes.
If you go loan route, does that put a lien on your property?
With all the loan options we have, the lien is going to be on the equipment itself, not the house.
That doesn't make sense. That means it's part of the house, so it's a lien on the property.
It won't be a property lien. It'll be a lien on the system itself. I think we have the financing folks here. We have somebody from SunGage and from Dividend. So feel free to talk to them about it. What? Yes.
What about animals? I have a lot of animals, squirrels and birds that makes nests anywhere and everywhere.
Yeah. I mean that kind of falls under maintenance. Is you want to watch out for things sometimes like to nest in panel arrays. We do have optional guards that we can put up if you know that your house gets assaulted by squirrels and things all the time.
President,
yes.
We know that the technology continues to advance in terms of the efficiency of the solar panels. What kind of things are in place? If you get a couple of 10 or years down the road, what's the plan for replacing those?
So the question was, as panel technology advances, is there going to be an option to replace the panels? It's not going to be part of this program where you're going to be able to replace your panels. It is theoretically an option. You could pull the panels off and replace them, hopefully without switching out the racking. In most cases, it doesn't look like you're going to want to do that. So we have systems from back in 2004 and forward. I don't know of a single instance where somebody has taken their old panels off, because although the technology is advancing, it's a fairly slow, steady march. The average we've seen over those 10 years is about 5 watts per panel per year. So I mentioned we're 315-watt panels. That's a tiny fraction. So the other question people have, or the anxiety they have, is should I wait until the next big advancement? If you look at the numbers, you know, if you wait 5 years for the more advanced panels, as panel technology is advancing now, it's going to take decades for you to catch up with the savings that you would have seen if you installed right now. In the back.
This PowerPoint display, do you have that available, or do you just have this?
Can we put it on our website? I think we can, yeah. I think we have the technology. So we'll try and get these slides for this presentation up on the website so you can take another look at it.
This will be the Solarize North Haven website.
Solarize North Haven website.
The one that's on the bottom of the sheet.
The one that's on the sheet, yep.
Oh,
yeah, another thing Kristen just mentioned, we have a frequently asked questions sheet that you'll be able to find on the table in the back, so if there's any other questions we don't get to. I don't think I have heard from you back there.
Question going back to the issue of a home fire. Let's say if you have one in the attic, for example.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned that the power optimizers would, when you're setting them up, the fire department would be able to shut the power off to the internal house grid without, you know, effectively. However, isn't it the case that the solar panels themselves are going to continue to produce power and create a hazard to the firemen if they have to get access to that part of the grid?
That is the case. So the question is, back on how firefighters deal with PV systems. With this system, the power optimizers are going to shut down the wiring from the panels down through the house. However, those panels are still going to be live, so they're not going to want to put an axe through that. There are training programs that firefighters go through on how to deal with that. Usually what it means is if they need to vent the roof or something like that, they'll just do it on the north side of the roof where there is no solar. My brother's a firefighter over in San Jose, California, so it's important thing for me too.
I don't want to end the questions yet, but I just want to announce a couple of things before people
absolutely.
Leave. This is our first event. We're going to try to have one each month, and so we're having another workshop on Tuesday, March 1st at the Energize Connecticut Center, which if you haven't been down there, it'd be great to go. I've never been there. That's from 6 to 7:30. That's over on Universal Drive. And another one will be on March 24th, which is a Thursday, at the Library Community, North Haven Library Community Room, from 7 to 8:30. And also join us on April 19th, which is Earth Day at the high school.
Are those on the website?
Those will be on the website.
The dates will be on the website. Yes?
Are you better off getting the solar system on the ground than on the roof?
It depends on what you mean by better off. So the question is, are you better off putting the system on the ground rather than on the roof? So typically, if you have the system mounted up on the roof, because it's going to be higher up in most houses, you're going to get more sun on the roof than you get on the ground. If you do have a great big open area in your yard or you're next to a field or something, there are advantages to it. The nice thing is you can point it directly south. You don't have to worry about replacing your roof ever because it's sitting there on the ground. So there's definitely some advantages. The way this program works, anything that's an option instead of this kind of basic system that's a roof-mounted system, there will be a cost adder, and your solar designer will be able to go through what those options are, ground mounts being one of them. Yep.
Is there any, I think I might have seen the slide that alluded to the financing of the PDRA 36.99.
Yeah, so the 20-year loan option, it's dependent on FICO score, on credit score. It averages out to around 7%. There are some shorter-term loans that have lower interest rates, and again, your system designer can go over all those with you. Right there.
Just to answer this, as far as weight, we have a tall box, big roof, big angle.
Yeah, let me get that just 1 second. What were you going to say, Janice?
Yeah. It as a convenience, but you can do your own financing and pay for it in cash any way you want.
Yeah, that's a good point. We like the financing options that we have. I use them on my own house, but we're not married to them, so if you want to try a different route, then go for it. The question we had over here was, is there a lot of weight associated with a PV system on your roof? One that ties into the engineering assessment that'll have to be done. So there'll be a structural engineer that will sign off on the weight limitations of your roof and suggest if there's any sort of reinforcement that needs to be done. So that said, we will want to get into your attic when we're out to do our site assessment. The PV system itself is actually not a lot of weight. It's about 4 pounds per square foot, which is roughly the same weight as a layer of asphalt shingles. So as long as your roof structure is meeting code and you don't have more than one layer of asphalt shingles on your roof, you should be all set. Yes? Yeah, the question is there's a lot of other solar companies out there that have zero down financing options. There's actually a lot of them, and feel free to compare our numbers to other companies. The differences can be a broad range. The one financing model that comes to mind is called a PPA, a power purchase agreement. And in that case, it's kind of like having an alternative power supplier where instead of, it's like a solar lease where you don't own the system, but you're buying the power that comes off of the system at a per kilowatt hour rate. So we prefer this model where you just have one fixed predictable price every month. PPA. Yeah, Kenny just said there's an article out in the Hartford Current.
Yeah, it might be the New York Times.
Or maybe New York Times, talking about different financing models that are out there and ones to watch out for and just to understand them fully. Feel free if you've ever gotten a solar quote from another company, bring it, have it out when we come out. We can compare and contrast if you like.
Some companies have a strong light solar, other companies.
return to, if you've got this system, does the utility take over?
So the question is I think you said, God forbid, Sunlight Solar goes under. And yeah, so it's not really a question of the utility. So the question is, if Sunlight Solar sometime in the future is no longer around, we hope to be around for a very long time, but if we're not, if you've done one of the 20-year loans, part of that package is that they're going to do warranty management. So you'll be able to turn to the finance company, and if Sunlight Solar is not around, they'll have other companies around that are able to do maintenance on their systems.
Any one or two questions for us?
Why is there a deadline?
Why is there a deadline?
Yeah.
Yeah, you want to.
I mean, we have a set campaign. That's the way this runs. We're trying to run this for that many months, so we have to have some endpoint. That's something. And Kate is, she's not around, but she would. That's the way they run it. Solarize.
It's also volunteer driven. So Kenny and the other members of the Clean Energy Task Force are volunteering their time to this program. So we don't want to have this drag on for years and years. We want a focused short time, you know, long enough that people can get an assessment and get signed up, but we don't want dragging on forever.
One last question, or
what's the average lifespan of a solar cell?
Of a solar cell or the whole system?
One of those panels.
Oh, one of those panels, on the order of 30 or 40 years.
Yes. Does it degrade over time?
It does. Good question. So the panel output does degrade slightly over time. The industry accepted standards about 0.5% output per year on a 25-30 year time scale. So we're going to stick around, and we'll answer any more questions if you want to just find one of the Sunlight Solar people. But I think we'll close it down.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for coming.
I just wanted to make one correction. It's April 9th. There's a mistake in terms of Earth Day. It's on April 9th, if you wrote that down. So thank you so much for coming. As Brennan said, he'll be around. We'll be around. Thank you so much for coming.
Yeah, absolutely.
The preceding program is brought to you in part through a grant from the town of North Haven. Watch town meetings or other videos on demand at nhtv.com. Like us on Facebook and subscribe to us on YouTube.